Here you brother, go right ahead. What's your question?
I want to start by thanking both of these gentlemen. During my days at Howard, your knowledge that you provided us during that time period has brought me a long ways. I'm pretty sorry to give thanks for you. Appreciate that, brother. And Brother Malik, you know, I see you every Tuesday, brother. You know what time it is. It's regular work.
Yes, that's right.
I don't know where that brother went to about the public schools. I just retired after 12 years. And I didn't see much of you brothers coming there to work with our students. And I'm going to say this to you right now. Most of you don't even know what goes on in those public schools. All right? Okay. It's like a prison system. Okay? The curriculum is controlled. So I have to fill in the gaps because there's too many missing. I'm coming to my question. I want to hear from the law students at Howard when I ask this question. I'm coming to it, sis. All right. In the 90s, before I even entered the teaching profession, I was in the community in Washington, D.C. During those times in the 90s, for those of you who were in D.C. during those times, you know that we had a crack epidemic.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I went mentoring. I don't know about that brother back there, but I went mentoring. And one of the houses I had to go through to get the student into my program, when I walked through in the middle of the day, the grandmother was drinking, and the mother looked like she was strung out on crack. I didn't find out until later, because when I was walking down there, a police officer pulled me over and asked me if I was lost. Because I didn't know I was walking into a battle zone between the drug dealers. And that was a drug house that I was walking into. But these are the things I was willing to do during my days at Howard. But not a lot of students are willing to do that today. I'm on campus. And I know what the mentality is like on campus. But see, I can't fault you because I had a Kwame Ture before he passed come to us and give us a command.
Yeah.
My question is this. And that's some time, brother. We're going to keep it. Does the attachment of the color black to power and nationalism undermine the copper-skinned indigenous Americans' recognition for their stolen land? And I'm defining this on a Noah Webster's definition in 1828 dictionary, which defines who the real American is, and not the European that attached themselves to that name. They knew who we were when we got here. Not all of us came over from Africa. So I want that question addressed. Now, that was probably addressed to the students of the Howard Law School. Is that right?
You all ready? You ready?
Yeah. Exactly. You seem to want to hear from me. What I want to say is this. We got to, we in the teaching phase right now, and I don't know if you want. Do you want to hang out in the lobby for a while?
Brother, I'll hold on until I drop.
Where you holding your lobby?
My plane don't leave. I think you're working with a man like this.
No. I came here to work now, so we're going to... Okay, so I would say this.
We want to answer all the questions.
That's right. And I want to speak to all of y'all. I want y'all to meet Dr. West and whatever, but guess what? This has been such an awesome session. It has gone to the last hour. I want to answer that question. The answer is no. Number one, the answer is no. Us saying black power does not undermine the indigenous. I mean, that's the short answer. Now, let's get deeper into it. But the answer's no only if we start talking about the land and how we're going to divide the land and we start dictating the terms on the land we don't own. All right? We cannot dictate anything. We must ask permission. All right?